Welcome back for our first game of the day as the Lions look to correct their mistakes from yesterday against a very strong-looking Super Hot Crew. Now, yesterday, the Lions were in a commanding position against Rockat. I say commanding almost in the loosest terms. They were ahead in that game, but they lost it out in the end.
Yeah, and at this point in time, Alliances continue to show this hit-and-miss ability. They win everything one week, they lose everything the next. And in their loss yesterday, it wasn't quite as dramatic as that. They held even and traded blow for blow with Rockat until when one very poor decision in the late game ended up costing them.
Yeah, we actually have a video clip of that decision. It was a barren blunder that cost them the game.
Yeah, so if you take a look at the replay we're going to run through very quickly, let's actually start this one right now. 6-7 on kills. Gold is about 1,000 difference at 40 minutes on the clock. And if you look at your minimap, you'll notice that Froggen is going to arrive to this party late, but so is the rest of Rockat. Tabs tanks the Baron the entire time. All of that damage on Tabs' HP bar was from poor positioning and from the rest of the team trying to engage on Zazzus. Because the game is at 40 minutes in, the three kills that are secured in the pit allow Rockat to literally just rush down the Nexus. It was a decision that I think as a team, they all gone back to the board and or back to the scoreboard and said, why did we do that? Why did we try rush it? They didn't have the damage. It just was a poor call. The rest of the game, however, was good. Talking about the team that has been underperforming, this is a rematch of the week one game between Alliance and Super Hot Crew, where Froggen played LeBlanc. The team struggled, and his LeBlanc had little to no impact. So We'll see how he does today.
Well, Super Hot Crew, on the other hand, played a slow but calculated game against the Copenhagen Wolves, where they turned that small advantage into a very decisive finish.
Yeah, Wolves had absolutely no answer to the split push and the map play coming out of the Super Hot Crew. Mr. Rolls once again did very well in Lucian. His overall stats are 26-6-17, which are great statistics, and he picked up a solo inhibitor uncontested. Last week, when the team of Super Hot Crew destroyed Gambit, it was entirely due to Vi being given to Impaler, and then his synergy with Mimer and Moops. They invaded, conquered, and captured Gambit's Nexus in the fastest game of the LCS.
And speaking of Impaler, Shock sat down with the Super Hot Crew's jungler to find out how he became a pro player and the wild ride that he and his team have had getting into the LCS.
First off, I'd like to get to know a little bit more about you personally as a gamer. How did you get involved with League of Legends professionally?
I started off playing like random tournaments online, and then one day my friend needed a dropout for a tournament for a LAN. So I was like, oh, I've got nothing to do tomorrow, I can come down. And they're like, yeah, just come. So two random people came and picked me up, and then I was like, yep, don't really know these guys, but we went to the tournament in the UK called iSeries, and then we won, and that's how it all began.
So you were playing AD carry then, and was that the first taste that you got of playing professionally, and did that wake something up inside you, like, I really want to pursue this?
Yeah, initially I played AD carry, but I preferred like the decision-making side of the game. So from there I went to mid, where there's a bit more decision-making. You decide if you roam or how you can affect like counter-jungling and all that. But then eventually I wound up in the jungle because that's where you make most of the decisions around the game.
And then you come here to the big stage to qualify for LCS versus SK Gaming. And I believe you made a quote for yourself, it wasn't fun playing like that on the main stage. Tell us about that experience.
Originally when we won the first game, everyone's like, yeah, we got this now. We spoke between the games, like, yeah, we know we can do this. Because the first game is like the biggest shock because everyone's there and it's a really important match. And then we won the second game and it's like, yeah, just one more win now and then we're like home free. And then the third game and we lost because they adapted their play style around how we play. And because we were a new team, we could only really play one style. And we refused to like adapt to how they adapted to us. And then we went 2-2.
If they cannot shake off this defeat, they may not be able to win game 5.
And suddenly everyone's like, oh damn, we can actually lose this. And then 2-3 and we lost on main stage. It's really bad losing and feeling like you were a big impact on the loss. And I didn't feel good at all.
You felt personally responsible?
Partially, yeah. Because we didn't adapt, I was forced to play the same style even though we were losing. And as soon as they know what you're going to do every game, then you've pretty much lost already.
Where were you or what were you doing when all of a sudden you heard, there's going to be a play-in, we get a second chance?
I didn't even have the spot at that point because they went back to playing with the old lineup and I was just like, meh, doing my own thing. And then suddenly they're like, oh, things of our jungle aren't really working out and we want to try you again. And I'm like, oh, I've done all this before. I do not want to lose again. And I was cautious at first to even accept the offer of trying to play again. And they tried like three junglers and they came back to me and said, yeah, we'd like to try you. And I said, okay, but if it's like it was before, then I won't come back. And luckily things changed. We got Mr. Rallis instead.
Tell me a little bit about growing up with games and esports, and you're obviously very young, you're 18 years old. Did you actively see that growing, or was that something that was always there for you?
I played at the end of season one. I was like, oh, season one World Finals, that looks cool. And then season two World Finals, wow, that looks amazing. And now season three World Finals is just crazy, like $2 million prize pool or whatever it is, and SKT dominating everybody. And now I'm thinking season four World Finals, could I be there? Like, maybe I could grow up with esports and esports would become, I don't know, my life.
There's definitely a chance for Impaler to make it to Worlds this season, that's for sure. I mean, you should never even think about giving that dream up at this point.
Definitely not. And it's been a very bumpy ride. You see how topsy-turvy it is. The team of Super Hard Crew only actually qualified for the LCS 2 days before we were officially meant to start. You know, 2 or 3 days before, they'd had that play-in on the Saturday against Meteor Makers and swept them 2-0, and they've been performing phenomenally on the big stage.
Yeah, on a bit of a roll here. So let's get towards the game and check out the starting lineups. On the blue side, it's Alliance with Wicked in the top lane, Shook in the jungle, Froggen in the mid lane, the AD carry Tabs, and support is Niff.
And on the red side, it is the Super Hot Crew. Mimer up top, Impaler, the man we just heard from in the jungle, Moops in the mid lane, Mr. Ryles as your AD carry, and Mixer as your support.
So, as we get towards Champion Select, let's talk a little bit about the bans here. One thing that we can say with absolute sureness is the fact that the junglers for both of these teams have been targeted heavily.
Yeah, definitely. And I think both of these junglers, Shook and Impaler, have struggled to adapt in the opening weeks of the LCS. Their main champions were being taken away. It was Vi for Impaler. It was Elise for Shook. And I think a lot of the other teams have realized that if you prevent them getting the jungle, if you take the jungle picks away and they can't get their solo lanes going, that's a strong way to beat these teams.
What about the other lanes here as well? We mentioned the Lucian for Mr. Oz has been incredibly strong so far. Could we see a ban go in that direction?
I don't know if you're gonna value banning Lucian because there's so many other picks, the likes of Kayle, the likes of Gragas. Also these top laners, both Wicked as well as Mimer, play very similar sort of tanky, bruisery top lane champions, and that could also be a focus.
Well, first ban out of the gate will be Fi. Surprise, surprise. Aim straight at Impaler there. Cassidy in a standard red side ban taken away from the Super Hot Crew. Then we'll see actually Caitlyn taken away here, interestingly enough, by Alliance towards Mr. Ryles.
So Caitlyn has been played 5 times by Mr. Ryles. He's only got 2 wins on it, 3 losses. Lucian, he's also played 5 times. And you can see with how quickly the bans are going through here, Alliance are making it clear they don't want to run the risk of having that long-range poke of Caitlyn in their faces.
And LeBlanc was taken away, so 2 bans aimed towards Froggen. At this point, of course, he brought his Anivia out yesterday, which I think surprised all of us that that was going to happen. Elise, of course, the final ban for Alliance, so they got something else in mind for
Kayle.
First pick.
It has to be Kayle. I think Alliance are trying to force Super Hot Crew to decide what to ban in that mid lane. The fact that they've removed Pantheon and removing, you know, Elise from the pick, well, I'm way off. They're definitely targeting that Lucian. They don't want Mr. Rolls on it, but that's potentially given over Renekton, Kayle, Thresh, Gragas. There's a lot of very big, impactful champions they could run. They could even pick up like a Wukong in the jungle if they wanted to snare the next high-priority jungler right now.
Well, it's most definitely going to be the Thresh. That's already locked in, as is the Wukong. So you're on the mark with that one. To be honest, I say not many junglers left up, and there's still obviously a whole plethora of them, but the strong ones right now, Vi, Elise, and Pantheon, all taken away. They settle for it this time around. That leaves the likes of Yasuo open even. That's actually been banned quite a lot. In fact, the first 4 games of this season, they were banned. It was banned every single time against Alliance.
Yeah, nobody wants to let that assassin through for Froggen. It's quite interesting to see if they're going to consider it, because you need to combo it with some additional knockups, knockbacks. Generally, we've seen Vi plus Yasuo working because it's a guaranteed knockup, as well as getting the ability to land that last breath. What we have seen though from other teams is replying with like a support Morgana. You stick the black shield down, you can't be knocked up. The fact that Thresh has already been locked in makes it a little bit safer for Alliance to consider, and we'll have to see if they decide to go for it as this picks and bans progresses.
Well, Lee Sin, Trundle were the picks there for Alliance in that one. Super Hot Crew going to be picking around, and interesting to see where Mr. Rolls actually goes from this one. Caitlyn obviously banned. We've seen that the Lucian has been taken away from him. He has already played, for example, Ezreal. In fact, he played it in the last game that these two teams played against each other. 2-1-6 is where Rolls finished in that one. But right now, they're hovering over Lissandra and Twitch.
Well, we'll see how they get locked in. I want to touch on the Trundle from Wicked just very quickly. He's sticking with the traditional tanks, and we actually seen yesterday his Renekton didn't work out, was outscaled by Rockat's Zazzus and his Trundle in the top lane. So I quite like Wicked deciding to go for that, realizing that a lot of the other picks were up and available. The longer this game goes, the better that Trundle's going to become.
So Lissandra in there with Jinx this time around. So that was the choice for this one. Actually, they've only won one game. Actually, that's a lie. They played against Gambit as well with that link, Jinx. Oh, Gambit played it against them. But either way, that's going to be the choice this time around for Mr. Ralls.
A little bit of an unsafe pick here for Super Hard Crew. Jinx Thresh is going to be a little bit safer in lane in that the Lantern's going to be there to pull Jinx out of the fray, get her out safely. However, this Lissandra is going to be so impactful at slowing down Trundle and Lee Sin when we get into these team fight stages. If Lissandra is unable to get the slows down and get her ultimate from the Frozen Tomb to split up the Alliance members, I actually think it's quite scary to have this Jinx. We've heard Reckless speaking out quite strongly about how he feels that because it's so easy for certain champions to get onto you as Jinx, it's not worth picking her. He prefers to play the slightly safer long-range champions and mobile champions like Lucian and Caitlyn.
So the final two picks here for Alliance, and we talked about Kayle earlier on, getting through the bans this time around, and Froggen is going to get his hands on Kayle. They also picked Leona in there as a support.
So it's a very good composition from Alliance. I think they have a strong early game. They've got Leona, they've got Lee Sin that'll help out the lanes. He's very good early ganks. Leona Lucian is going to struggle against Jinx Thresh if they go for the 2v2 until they hit level 6. But once they hit level 6, you've got all in, you have kill potential there. So Alliance do well at multiple stages of the game. We are seeing a Gragas locked in for a double AP comp now on the side of Super Hot Crew. And this means we're most likely going to see the top lane Lissandra. This is what we've seen multiple times throughout the last split of the LCS when Lissandra was very popular and played often. And I don't know. I think there's a little bit reliant on popping somebody quickly with the Gragas Lissandra combo. And if Super Hot Crew can't do that, I'm a little bit nervous about the sort of quasi-wombo combo composition.
It's an interesting choice in the lane there against Trundle as well. If you think about that one, Trundle's going to be trying to get up in your face this entire time, and you can lock him up with your W every single time that he comes anywhere near you, trade a bit of damage, and just back away from that one. Great mobility as well that you've got in there to start fights. You've got the ability to stay safe as well from that one, obviously, to with you all yourself. So interested to see how this one works out. We have to make a big note about this one right now. Double AP comps up until now have not had success.
No, they definitely haven't. And you actually heard Pekka during the interview, the pregame interview today, saying that had Soaz picked up a kill with his top lane LeBlanc against the tanks in the top lane, it could have worked out for him. It's going to be a similar situation now for Mima on this Lissandra. If he can get ahead early, he has all of the tools to control the Trundle, but he needs to get ahead early.
Well, let's see who you guys were thinking are going to win this one. Checking out your votes. According to lolesports.com, 67% of you think that Alliance are actually going to come out and take this one. Let's not forget, Alliance are definitely a team that don't play well for some reason on odd-numbered weeks. Weeks 1, 3, and 5, up until now, obviously, this is their second game. They've not picked up a win. Even-number weeks are good for Alliance. So if it continues like this, who knows what's going
to
happen?
Well, we'll have to see how well they play this early game out. I think they have the tools to get kills. They have the tools to actually get control of the game. And if they can get control, they have a great composition for maintaining control. Leona's good at diving. Kayle's going to be able to have so much damage as Froggen begins to scale up with her. And I just want to see what Super Hot Crew are going to do once they hit 6. Because there's a very big power spike. Once Lissandra has her ultimate and the ability to lock somebody down, you then have so much burst damage and AoE from that jungle and the top laner combined. But much like we've seen with all Wukongs, if you can't get in, if you don't have a clean opening, you're unable to win those convincing team fights.
And Kayle just turns into an absolute monster late game. We've seen it time and time and time again. In fact, the win over Millennium, which happened last week for Alliance, Froggen played a 9-2-8 Kayle, which once you start really getting in there in terms of items far enough into the game, it's very hard to stop that one. So we'll see how the Super Hot Crew deal with that one and how these combos are going to work out for both teams. Up until now, we're seeing a very normal split across the entire map.
So there's one thing I do want to talk about with regards to that intervention. Because of the amount of area of effect damage that Super Hot Crew have, basically every single one of their damage-dealing champions has some form of splash or AoE. That intervention is going to become a lot less game-changing because it's going to hit the entire team. Oh, Impaler's taking a lot of it.
Impaler's going to get caught out here, but I don't think they can follow in and chase that one down. Wicked just chomping on that ward, but Impaler losing a little bit of health. Shouldn't affect him too much here, although did have to work through one of his pots there from the start. But he's going to go back off to his red. That'll start things out. Now this bottom lane getting into position. Rawls and Mixer versus Niff and Tabs. We'll see who gets the early blows in this one.
Rawls and Mixer are always aggressive early. Every single time we've seen them. Look at Mixer's position. He's going to get caught by Niff.
And they put the ward down. And actually Mixer taking a burst of damage there from Tabs. But they managed to give it straight back onto him. We can see already those cookies being nommed on by the guys in the bottom lane.
So I think even trade, because both of the supports come away with roughly the same amount of HP lost. Well, I just want to take note of the fact that Mixer has got an exhaust as opposed to an ignite in this laning phase. So he's anticipating the later game fights, planning to exhaust the Trundles and the Kales when the bigger fights erupt. It makes it a little more difficult to getting low level kills against this Leona Lucian lane.
Well, let's see how that one all works itself out. Rawls and Mixer have started how they've really gone about their other games as well, being very, very aggressive. This top lane going to be interesting. It's all about the ice up there with Trundle versus Lissandra. Very interesting to see how this one comes out. Just a quick note, if we think back to last season where Mimer played for Ninjas in Pyjamas, we always used to rave about how tanky champions were definitely his forte. But on these, you know, squishier champions, I think we can say are a little bit more unforgiving if you're out of position or what have you, he's really struggled on.
Yeah, he hasn't had the same level of impact. You know, Mimer in this particular season, in this split, has been doing very well in the split pushing, the very farm heavy champions. I must admit, though, I like the Lissandra against a Trundle and a Kayle because, much like a Nivea yesterday with Froggen played, she has the tools to control a Kayle quite effectively. And you'll find that quite similarly from Lissandra with her Ice Shard. The Q just going to repeatedly apply slows, makes it very difficult for the quite short-range Kayle, Trundle, and Lee Sin to get in those fights.
Get in there and chase this mid lane then, Kayle versus Gragas, certainly a lane that we've become more and more used to seeing. Moops, who, for me, he's again been strong, incredibly good when Super Hot Crew have won, but he's had little to maybe no impact in the games that they've struggled in and ended up losing.
So when we look at Moops as a player and we consider what he does for the Super Hot Crew, I feel like when he is replying and working with Impaler or Mimer, he does very, very well. He's not necessarily a leader, a spearhead for the team, the way Froggen or Pekka is for their respective teams. However, that's Moops just taking way too much damage. And take a look at Shook coming in from behind. If a Sonic Wave connects, they may even be able to get him here.
I think that's the best position that they're going to get. There is a Body Slam coming out. Wave of minions already blocking off that Sonic Wave possibility from Shook, and he will simply safeguard out of that one. Wukong, Impaler, who we heard from in the pregame, great interview with him there. He revealed a little bit about his start in the UK esports scene. He, again, you know, he's been taking a lot of flack, I think, because he's always been banned out of games. Whenever he picks up a new champion, when he played Pantheon for the first time and did well with it, people just don't let him have it afterwards.
Yeah, I mean, his team actually banned out Pantheon, a champion he's played well with. We also seen Vine Elise banned out from Alliance. So he's a player who has taken a lot of pressure from the picks and bans phase, but he's risen to the occasion. Every time we've said, what's Impaler going to play next? What sort of impact can he have? He finds a champion that he can have a meaningful contribution. He played Wukong yesterday, went 2-1-8. And right now he's trying to set up his first gank. If Mixer doesn't get a death sentence, though, I don't think there's enough CC for this one to work out. So we'll see if Mixer can make it land.
Well, he will get the flay and the hook there on towards Niff. The chompers are down. Exhaust comes in on towards Niff. There's too much locking him up, but Niff will flash away. The zap blocked out by Tabs, and that's brilliant there. Niff managing to survive it. Did have to use his flash out of that one, but crucially, doesn't give up the first blood.
And it was so smart. Niff actually used the Zenith Blade to just get a little bit further down the bush line and then immediately flash over the members of Super Hot Crew. Fact of the matter, though, is it's a successful gank from the Super Hot Crew. They got the flash out of Niff, and if he gets caught by another death sentence in the next couple of levels, there's going to be an easy kill.
Speaking of easy kills, I'm not sure this is one of them in the mid lane. Moops there, getting slowed down. He's going to have that body slam, but there is the safeguard to the ward. The Q lands, and Shook follows through. That's first blood for Alliance. Perfectly, perfectly done.
Very well played. I like the fact that Shook actually dashes to the ward with his safeguard. That's going to allow him to just land a very easy Sonic Wave at point-blank range, and that just gives him a nice chunk of gold to work with. In this bottom lane, the aggression continues as they caught Niff.
Hook again on towards Niff. The chomper's going to go up. He's stuck there. He's got 1-0 Black from that last engagement, but Tab doing good damage back from this one. Tabs will eventually have to dash away as Nif goes low, but again, survives the death sentence.
So much additional defensive statistics from that Eclipse. The W of Leona made it very difficult for Mr. Rolls to burn through that HP. We did see very good play from Tabs. He immediately focused Mr. Rolls down, continued landing auto attack after auto attack, and it forced Super Hawker's Geo to sort of back out of going for that kill.
Now this top lane perfectly even on farm at this point. See that Mima starting to push those waves heavier and heavier up on towards Wicked. I'm interested to see how Wicked itemizes this one. You'd expect maybe straight up towards that Spirit Visage, make him almost unable to be killed in that top lane without a full-on all-in and probably some jungle pressure as well, but Wicked has gone some interesting ways, let's say, when he's built.
Yeah, he has gone interesting ways, and we'll touch on that as we see Impaler catching Shook out, trying to go for a red steal. Baron doesn't spawn for a few more minutes, Shook. It's not there to safeguard or Sonic Wave 2. Just going on the items, I actually think that with both of the top laners running Flash Teleport and not having Ignite, it's a little more difficult to try and go for a kill presence. So he may play it safer. Nif gets caught by another hook.
Yeah, there's a hook on him, but honestly, he's already so tanky from this one. You can see that in that last fight, it took them so long to get him low that it almost cost, or I say cost, almost cost them, you know. Tabs got Mr. Rolls quite low in that last one as they were trying to finish off Nif, and they know that they have to be careful with that one with the trades. There's the hook coming out. Perfect aim, just didn't have the range for Tabs because he dashed away.
Mixer's lane presence has been phenomenal in these opening 8 minutes. He's landed multiple hooks. He's forced Tabs and Nif to be on the defensive. However, I don't think they've built up enough of a CS lead. They've been trying to keep Tabs and Nif low and try to punish that sort of lane bully strength that they have right now, but that ticking time bomb is about to wear off as both Tabs and Nif are going to hit level 6 and they're going to be able to use that, you know, ultimate combo and CC from Leona to lock up Mr. Rolls if they can catch him.
Well, we're seeing the first blue buffs being given over to those mid laners at this point. We're seeing Chalice in for Gragas as Wicked going on towards Mima. Locked him up there, but with a good pillar coming in. And that's his second tool that he's got. Mima can use his the Claw of Doom to get away from things. And he does it quite spectacularly as well.
Mima should not be picking fights with Wicked when he's got his Frozen Domain down. When that W's thrown out from Trundle, Mima should back away because the additional movement speed is going to allow Wicked to kite some of those ice shards and potentially even dodge them because he's got such a nice movement speed increase. So we'll see how Mima continues to play it. He's been a little patient, as I were. There goes the culling. They've got Nif.
They've got to go all in on this one. Actually, Mixer going to get locked up here in the Leona ultimate, but have they got the damage turning it around here? Nif going to be finished off by the Super Mega Death Rocket. Mima teleports it down towards his bottom lane as well. He's got the support out of there. The top laner came down. That's a four-man team in the bottom side of the map here for Super Hot Crew to go for Dragon.
Yeah, they're going to be able to get free reign on this one. If Shook tries to steal, maybe he can make it happen. He is making no motion for this at all. They're going to give this one up. And that was just Mr. Rolls and Mixer being very, very smart. They stayed in the bush. They actually baited Alliance to think that they had recalled and, returned to base. And once the culling was used to kill the wave, that was a massive let's go now signal. Super Hot Crew engage. They manage to catch Nif. They get them killed, and it lands on Mr. Rolls, which is very important. And they secure that Dragon for a nice, healthy gold lead.
And I really like what they did there. They knew that that top lane was going to get pushed out. So they sent the mid laner to top and let Mima come into this mid lane to cover from that one. So actually, there was no even half attempt at equalizing out that Dragon by pushing down that tower in that top lane. Wicked obviously couldn't get in there fast enough from that one. I'm interested to see whether they actually switch back. It does look like that's what they're going to do.
So this is actually something that Super Hot Crew did very well yesterday. They played the map, they played the lanes very effectively, and you touched on the fact that they've got two AP champions. You could actually put the Lissandra up against Kayle for a little bit of time. He's got a fair amount of safety, has similar tools to deal with that Kayle damage, and as it stands, they are going to return to their regular lane positions. But it's nice to see how Super Crew time the waves and time their champion movements to reduce the amount of risk of losing those turrets.
You can see that kill down the bottom for Mr. Rolls has actually given him BF Sword plus the Vamp Scepter and Boots as well, so he does have a nice little advantage over his opposite number Tabs in this one. And with Impaler coming down towards his bottom lane, we may see the first Cyclone coming in.
Yeah, it is available. He does have Flash as well. So let's see if Mixer, he doesn't have Box. He's going to use a Lantern. And Lantern times out.
Oh, the Lantern times out, but he managed to land the hook there on towards Tabs. That's a good flash away before the Flay could land onto him. Tabs stays safe. It was all a little bit clunky, that from the Super Hot Crew, unfortunately. Could have been perfect. Didn't quite work that way.
Little bit of a misplay from Mixer. Just, you know, pulling that lantern a little too far, so Impaler wasn't able to hitch a ride. He does manage to connect the hook onto Tabs, though, and that forces the flash. So even without Impaler's presence, Mixer once again landing a very, very crucial death sentence, making Tabs and Nif play a little bit defensive in that lane. It's not working out too much. It's only a 6 CS difference, so you do have to give credit to Tabs for how well he's been farming. But look at the route now that Impaler's taking. He's gone all the way deep into the jungle, placed a very deep Wraith ward. They may consider a tower dive, but this is risky against the Leona, who's super tanky.
No wards in there. They're pushing up that wave now. Will that alert Alliance to what's about to hit them? Minion wave coming in behind them here as well. And you can see Ral's just auto-attacking straight through those minions, trying to put as much poke damage down as he can. So here we go. Minions tanking up the turret. Here comes Impaler from the side. Where are they going to go? They're aiming for Tabs. He gets right into the middle of them. Tabs is going to go down here. Who's tanking up the turret? That's Mixer. Now it moves off to Impaler. He needs to get away. It's Moops coming down from the mid lane as well. Nif takes a full blast of damage. He's not going to escape this one. Moops finishes him off with an auto-attack.
That was a very, very good dive from Super Hot Crew. The positioning of Mixer to throw down the lantern, tank up the turret, and actually pull Mr. Rawls to him to safety. They took next to no damage on the AD carry and support. Impaler was forced low, but he gets out cleanly. That was a great channel on that Cyclone, and Super Hot Crew have got a 3-1 kill advantage.
Very impressive stuff from Super Hot Crew. Shook, though, is actually invading right now. He's up by Impaler's red buff. Impaler is top side of the jungle, and we can see that Moops is coming down. Mimer's coming in as well, so they know that Shook is going to be around from this one. There is the Claw coming out from Mimer. He's going to ulti on towards Shook. Here comes Moops into the middle. They're going to follow Mimer through there from that one. Can they protect him? Oh,
he does.
Wow! He gets through. Mimer will survive it. They get the kill, and now Wicked in all kinds of trouble. Can he escape from this one? Moops not quite got the range on the body slam. Wicked will walk off.
I actually thought that Moops was being a little too hesitant on that explosive cast, and it worked out perfectly. He was waiting for Shook to dance around the map and use all of those flat-like abilities, the safeguard, etc., Sonic Wave, and then he just knocks him out of auto-attack range from Mimer, allowing Mimer to get out alive. So very good play. I do also want to touch on the fact that Shook, the moment he's seen that glacial path, that Claw of Doom flying through, he kicked Mimer to prevent it being second cast, and now they've caught Wicked.
They're going on to Wicked from this one. No messing around. Actually, it's Impaler who's tanking up the turret here very, very heavily. He's going to actually flash away from that one. They take down Wicked. Impaler's got almost no HP as Mimer now being chased down here by Froggen. There's the big slow. The auto attack's coming down. A killback from Froggen. And Impaler may just die here as well. Oh, the Jukes. He walks
That's
away, dodges away from the Q. Flash. Is he going to be able to get in from this one? He was already used by Shook. Oh, he gets in range just before he goes down to the turret.
Impaler needed to get out a little bit sooner to prevent giving over that kill, and very, very importantly, giving the double buffs back over to Shook. Now, Froggen was very smart in that mid lane, realizing Mimer didn't have his ultimate. He didn't have that Glacial Tomb available, so he just chased him down in between turrets and picked up what was actually quite an easy kill. The one thing I do want to touch on is that Impaler's ganks have been very, very good with this Wukong. He hit level 6, he's been a big impact. Froggen wants a tower.
Yeah, he wants the tower, and he's going to get the tower here, but how does he survive this one? There is intervention news. Moop's going to follow through. That's a good flash from Froggen, but can he escape? Here comes the Super Mega Death Rocket straight through. Oh, no! It doesn't hit. He goes straight through. That was so, so close to hitting Froggen.
One step. That was the difference there. One flap of the wings, as it were, if you're a Kale, manages to get past it. I actually think that was very smart play from Froggen. He got the tower down, and even if he had given up a kill on that tower, it's worth it. It's worth it to get that objective cleared and allow Froggen to get some more map control, especially if Alliance want to challenge for blue. Look at how much vision they have in and around this bottom half of the map. Both of the teams have littered the river with wards.
One question I have for you here moving forward is there's obviously right now a bit of a lack of a tank over for the Super Hot Crew, especially when you compare it to what Alliance have got. Wicked building himself up, he's going to become very hard to take down. Do they have the damage to actually completely work around that fact?
to work around Wicked if they can get to everybody else. So Sonic Wave connects. He's going to try steal. Wait for Sonic. He's got it.
He's got in from that one, but he doesn't get it. And Shook now in all kinds of trouble. He will actually fall from it. The Cullen actually coming through as well, but not going to be enough to save him. Shook goes down. His smite still available.
Yeah, didn't even use the smite in that particular situation. I think a risky attempt if it had worked out. Teleport's coming in from Mimer. They want Nip.
They're going in for Nip. He actually said he plays in there, but the Flay knocks him straight back. Nip trying to get away from this one, but he won't. Mimer picks up that kill. Wicked's coming down. Here's the damage on Satabs. He uses the barrier. There's a Flay on Wicked, but he is too tanky. He dodges a Super Mega Death Rocket, which would have killed Tabs, and they get one for nothing. They're probably going to have the tower as well.
Yeah, I think Super Haku can go for that tower. If Impaler and Moops want to dive Frog and the option is available to them, they decide against it right now. Mixer, once again, such a great play. He interrupts the Zenith Blade from Nif using a brilliant Flay, and then he lands the Death Sentence on Tabs. Moops is now caught.
He is caught as well. He's got to get that barrel down, and he does. Frog already using that intervention on himself. He'll get knocked up at the back. Shook taking a lot of damage, but they get the shutdown. But he will be finished off straight afterwards. Meanwhile, Froggen walked away on the top side. Impaler actually almost going down to Froggen in the end. That will be a one-for-one trade.
So you asked, how does Super Hot Crew get around the fact that Alliance have a tank? Well, they go for everybody else right now. Super Hot Crew are moving around the map. There have been so many ganks from Impaler that are actually working. Oh, it was a little close. And Super Hot Crew have got very good targeting in these team fights. They are the ones making the plays, meaning that Alliance have to play reactively. And because of the fact Super Hot Crew have got themselves a nice little lead, and they've got a lot of damage on their champions, that's why they've got this gold lead and double the kills.
And they may not have that tank in there. Zhonya's Hourglass, though, is now finished for Mimer. Almost double Zhonya's that he has now with that ultimate in. That obviously makes him a little harder to kill.
A lot harder to kill if he uses it on himself. I don't think he will, though. Impaler's now been caught out. He's going to at least get away. I actually expect that Glacial Tomb could be a very good tool for locking Trundle up in a team fight, and then using the Gragas Dispersion to get rid of everybody else, and either deciding to focus Trundle and then going for the 5v4, or if the Gragas Barrel is good enough, lock Trundle up, pop the AD carry or Kayle or somebody similar, and then carry on pushing for the team fight. So we'll see how Mimer decides to target. The one thing I just want to say very quickly about that previous jungle fight is the fact that Moops and Impaler use their ultimates at the same time, and a Gragas ulti and a Wukong ulti, they don't necessarily synergize very well together.
Yes, knocked up and all over the place from that one. Mimer not able to defend that bottom turret there. That was the second one of the game for Alliance's mid lane now taking some pressure as well. Both Moops and Impaler are there. Wicked's going to come around to try and cover. Will they risk actually sticking around for that one in the end? Nope. Wicked bites down on the decoy and in the end does manage to hold on to that tower, although it is very, very low HP. Alliance sending bit of a crack team to come up here as well to try and keep a hold on that as long as they can.
And something that we talk about and we bring up in every game nowadays is just how the Alliance wave clear is a little bit lacking. Now, the culling was just used by Tabs, but outside of that, you're going to be relying on the Piercing Light and the Righteous Fury from Kayle. There's no Gragas Barrels that's going to get rid of those. Impaler does have Flash, he does have Cyclone, so if Super Crew wanted to pick another fight, they could have gone for it. They're playing a little bit hesitant right now, but the option is there for them.
Could be a very good way to set things up. Super Crew, though, have already backed away from that one. It's clear that they don't want to get into a fight. So let's have a look down some of the items now that have been completed. The AD carries, we can see, a very different story there. Mr. Ross, 2-0-3, slightly ahead in CS. Tab's not going to kill just yet. He's got a Zeal on top of his Bloodthirster ahead in build as they're going forward. Shook, there is the ulti. The hook landing onto him as well. Actually flashes off to the backside, and he may lead them on a bit of a wild goose chase here. The ward over the wall safeguards off to it, and he baits out quite a lot there from the Super Hot Crew.
Very good play there from Shook, managing to get out considering the ultimates that were thrown down. To be fair, it was only the Cyclone, but that was three members of Super Hot Crew that had him locked down. There's no Solar Flare now, so Super Hot Crew have a better team fight.
Yeah, and Froggen is not there either. He's just taken down the outer turret in the top lane, but they're going to lose the inner turret for that one. Not really the kind of trade that Alliance will be happy with.
No, not at all. Super Hot Crew deciding they wanted the tower, not the kills. Demonstrating this, the objective play that we come to expect from them as a team. They've now backed away, and I think they should still be aware the Solar Flare is not available. So if you look how tightly knit Super Hot Crew have been for the last 2 minutes, they really want to find a fight. There's no Cyclone for this one. They're going to go in a Wicked.
Oh, they're going to go for Wicked. He actually takes the route out to the top and flashes away from the Zap. That's slow. If it had hit, could have spelled the end for Wicked, but in the end, it doesn't work out for them. And with 1 minute to go until Dragon, Support Crew will have amassed a decent amount of gold here to go back spend and come right back in time for that Dragon fight.
Yeah, they're going to be ready. Like over 1,000 gold and four members, 2,000 gold nearly there for Mr. Ralls. I think Super Hot Crew need to be a little bit careful with their borderline overly aggressive plays. If they continue to push that way and Alliance, you know, begins warding up a little bit better and anticipating it, they could get caught out. You can see right now, Froggen just waiting in the wings. He really wants to go on Mr. Riles, but I don't think Mr. Riles is going to be brave enough to push down the lane.
No, actually taking the white there from over the top of the wall. Froggen finds himself in the tri-bush all alone. Will more than likely just head out here once he realizes that he's alone in that lane and take himself that bit of farm that started to build up there. In the lane, you can see the player count on the left. Froggen using that time to communicate with his team. A bit of a lull in the action, a bit of downtime. And the funny thing is, because he's behind enemy lines here, so to speak, with this dragon coming up, he could catch them by surprise.
The fact he's got a death cap built up as his second item, as opposed to that Lich Bane, which we tend to see, also tells you he's going for burst. This is 4.1, so it's still 1-to-1 AP ratio on that Q of Kale. So if he can get to the squishies, of which there are many from Super Hot Crew, they will die very quickly. Right now, though, Froggen is still waiting out on the sides. If Mr. Rolls walks past, this could be so scary. That's a great ward. That's going to give away Froggen's position when he moves into the river. His teleport's coming down from Wicked.
Going to miss spotted there early. Wicked is going to come down the hook, landing on towards Shook. Dragon being stopped here by the Super Hot Crew as they back off somewhat. They're going to use that poke that they've got from those Gragas barrels to try and keep them away. Dragon now done damage, and there is the Solar Flare coming out. Impaler going to get focused. He goes very, very low as Mixer goes into the backline. Well, look at the ultimates coming down here for the Super Hot Crew. They've done so much damage, picked up two kills, and I have a feeling it's not over just yet. They're going to keep chasing down from this one. Tabs flashes away. Well, they chase down towards Froggen. He uses intervention on himself, but he is going to get locked up there by the Chompers. They'll be able to finish him off. He doesn't take the kill with him, and now they go for Shook. Oh, the Flay not quite connecting. Two men survived there for Alliance. Super Hot Crew still healthy, still got all five, going back to Dragon.
And we talked about the combination. Yes, there is a tank on the side of Alliance, but it doesn't matter when your attacking frontline gets locked up by that Glacial Tomb, and then you get knocked away by the Gragas ultimate. Super Hot Crew played that team fight absolutely perfectly, because Alliance just got split up by that hard dispersion. Looking at Impaler, he's gone for a damage build. He's got the makings of a Black Cleaver. This is something that Sinai did yesterday. We'll get to that in a second. Take a look at the team fight. Now, even though that's a great ultimate from Nif, the way that this Gragas barrel gets rid of Froggen, he's no longer in range. And with Shook, Nif, as well as Wicked being held in place by the Cyclone and being slowed by the Lissandra ultimate, Alliance were just too split up. They simply couldn't actually get to the damaging backline, and it was just very, very good play from Super Hot Crew to make the calls and for Impaler to come back to his team.
An interesting thing we didn't think of is you've got Wicked there at the front. Use the Frozen 2 on him. The ice that does the damage lasts for 3 seconds on that one. With Gragas, you can actually push him into the rest of the team. So even though you've used the ultimate on him, yes, he gets locked up, but you can still get that damage out to everyone else.
Yeah, and that's the power of that ultimate now from Lissandra. If you lock Trundle up, you can actually kill him. And without that Trundle on the front line, Lee Sin's got one kick. He's going to knock you away a little bit, but you've got very good kill potential. You get one kill on Mr. Rawls' Jinx. Going to get excited, have that passive movement speed up, and chase down the rest of Alliance. He's already got that Last Whisper and Static Shiv, a full item ahead of Tabs right now.
Blue buff being stolen away by the Super Hot Crew. That's one thing in their wins that they've done very, very well, is play the map smart. They've already got the wards down on that side of the map. They know around Baron they've got full control of that one as a hook. Well, not quite on target there for Mixer.
Shook was, I think Mixer was anticipating Shook to walk into the bush, and instead he walked towards the lane. So there's a little bit of a miscalculation on his part. They're not over yet. Now they're going to try to chase Shook down. The coin's been used.
Oh, they're going to chase in. Actually, get towards Wicked. The hook comes out. It lands on towards Nif. Box goes down as well. Have they got the damage here? Actually, they don't want that fight at this point. Not going to throw too much at the support.
No, the rest of the damaging ultimates had not been used. Now, Mima is not really able to deal with this very hard-hitting Froggen's Kale right now. So he's backed away from the lane. We'll see how Super Hot Crew play this one. They may lose an inner turret, and they're toying with Baron. They either want to bait it for a fight, or they want to try rush it because they've got so much damage so early.
Baron is Gonna get started off here by the Super Hot Crew. Rolls doing a good chunk of damage to that one. Impaler and Mixer on top of it as well. Mima does have his ulti up here so he can stop anyone getting in. Chuck in particular, you have to feel he's gonna be the target for that one. Once he actually gets around there, Baron is still being done. He's at half HP. They're gonna keep that one alive for now, but they back off. They're gonna chase down middle here. Mixer does land the hook on towards Wicked. Who are they gonna go for in the end? There is Impaler going right in the middle of them. Wicked actually with the intervention, but they get tagged. They've killed the AD carry there at the back. This could be a whitewash fight. Double kill comes out. Froggen's gonna die. He didn't have the damage to kill Mixer. Shook gets over the wall. Zap actually blocked by the Ray, so Shook survives barely. But well, that is four for nothing. Super Hot Crew can push such a big advantage here.
Super Hot Crew can grab themselves an inhibitor. Another perfectly played team fight that Super Hot Crew started. Split up. It was a 4-on-1 split. Mimo's coming in from the side. Impaler had 50% of his HP. He'd been tanking Baron up for so long that he was at a massive health disadvantage coming into that into the fight, but it didn't matter. The way Super Hot Crew are comboing the Cyclone, the Tomb, and the Gragas barrels for knock up and knock away is absolutely perfect. And Alliance, they can't deal with it. They can't burst anybody. This is the exact fight. Look at the HP bars sitting on the side of Super Hot Crew. Again, a decent enough solar flare. In comes the Cyclone, it keeps Wicked and Nip busy for so long. Froggen totally tunnels a Mima. Froggen had not used a single ability, you know, throughout the course of this fight yet, and Tabs gets completely caught up by Mima. Froggen was doing the right thing in theory, trying to prevent him getting in, and it just didn't work out.
Now play at the end there from Mixer as well, knocking the two remaining players back into his team, almost finishing off Shock. Quite enough damage there for that one, but it's 4-0 and 15-4 in kills overall, approaching a 10,000 gold lead here for the Super Hot Crew. That inhibitor's down as well, which piles all the pressure onto Alliance.
And it's very interesting that when you look at the compositions, you think that with a Leona on your side, with Trundle, with Lee Sin, that Alliance have the tools to initiate. Alliance have the tools to jump into team fights and pick them as and where they want to. Super Hot Crew has never given Alliance the chance to make a move. Alliance have been responding to the heavy ganks and to the heavy map play that Super Hot Crew is putting down. And because the SHC have built up this gold lead and this item lead, they can just keep throwing themselves at these fights, and it's working. You see Impaler, he wants another one.
They're gonna be able to get in there. Moop's actually coming through with the lantern. They do manage to get on towards Wicked. He's the tankiest of them all, and he's the most dead of them all for now as well. Lucian goes down, and that is just kills easily picked up by the Super Hot Crew. It leaves a 5-3 and a free Baron.
Yeah, there's nothing that Alliance can do to defend this one. We actually seen the teleport from Mima. He was pushing out the bottom lane. He comes in, gets another very good ultimate onto Tabs. Alliance are not responding well enough. They were not grouped up efficiently, and they just got caught out. Look at the body blocking here from Super Hot Crew. They want to eat that Sonic Wave to reduce the risk of a steal from Shook. Shook's still gonna try though.
Wow. He's still hanging around there in the backside as he goes further to the top. And look at Super Hot Crew rotating around there, trying to keep Shook away from this one. They're taking a lot of damage from that Baron, but actually they go over on towards Shook, and he's dead. Mima gets that one. That leaves them to finish off the Baron with only Nip hanging around. He can't get anywhere near it. That's another kill and the first Baron of the game for the Super Hot Crew. They are in such control now.
There's nothing that Alliance can do right now with the exception of hoping Super Hot Crew get caught out of position. At this point in time, Super Hot Crew have got so much of a damage lead that they can actually pick a slightly inopportune fight and maybe get away with it. However, if they get split up, if the burst of Kale actually kills Mr. Rawls and Jinx, for example, or gets rid of Moops before he can disperse anyone, that's how Alliance can win a fight. They need to get Super Hot Crew split up and out of position.
Actually, pushing this bottom lane now and just hiding out inside of the brush. Moops just off to the side of him, and Froggen's, is he going to go back here? He needs to be careful, because if he's to show himself now, Impaler's actually there. We can see that the recall already started off there. Super Hot Crew going down towards that dragon area, but a little bit wary of going in with just two men. They didn't have vision on where Shook was, and in the end, they all come down. Finish that one off safe. Very, very safe from Super Hot Crew.
Fourth dragon of the game. They're still warding. They've got four sweeping lenses on the side of Super Hot Crew, so they're denying the vision from Alliance. If you look at Mixer, he's 0-0-15 right now. I mean, his team has 18 kills, and the way Impaler started the game by ganking the bottom lane often, it just worked. It's something that Super Crew have rinsed and repeated and done over and over. They realize that Froggen is still trying to split push. Froggen's trying to get some form of map presence, but Super Hot Crew don't care. They've sent Mima to deal with them, and Mr. Rolls is pushing the top wave. So Super Crew will back away and go to their top inner turret.
Actually, that turret does go down there, so credit to Froggen. They're able to pick that one off. The Super Hot Crew, as you mentioned, going to head to the top lane now and take out that inner turret, which won't take them very long whatsoever. Rolls ripping through those turrets at this point. And actually, Mima's died on the top side, and Froggen didn't actually take a single bit of damage.
Mima didn't manage to get his ultimate off. He didn't use that. His Zhonya's Hourglass hasn't been used either, so he just got completely caught out during the course of that fight. And it's the burst we talked about. You know, Kayle sitting with that one-to-one scaling on her Q, had the Sheen, had the Death Cap, and just instantly popped him. Here's the replay of it. Mima's just going to get... Wow, that's three shots.
Froggen didn't even need to use his ultimate there either, but safe. Safe. I like that word. I mean, that's the danger. We mentioned it earlier on that this KO is going to turn fights the later it gets in this one. Lich Bane, Rabadon's Death Cap, got that Nashor's Tooth in there, got another blasting one on top as well. So there's a lot of damage coming from Froggen. They need to be careful about that one. Still the Super Hot Crew.
I still feel like the game is very much in Super Hot Crew's, it's their game to lose.
Yes.
And my reasoning for this is they have four damage sources. Even though Wukong's only got that Elder Lizard and a Brutalizer, he can put a lot of damage down onto the likes of Shook and Tabs if he gets a full channel on his Cyclone. Oh, Mima may be in trouble. Froggen's just hit level 18. This is going to be scary.
And there is Froggen going through. Wow! Ridiculous damage, and there is Froggen, uses his ultimate for style points underneath the turret. That's another one onto Mima, who's probably just like, so, well, what am I going to do?
I don't know if Mima's unbound his ultimate or his Zhonya's Hourglass. He flashes away, doesn't use his Hourglass, doesn't ult himself, doesn't do a thing. The rest of his team have secured a tower for the trade, so advantage Super Hot Crew, I guess, but Mima needs to get a little quicker on those reactions.
Well, you also have to think about it the other way, that if he uses his ultimate or his Zhonya's, he's probably dead straight afterwards, either way. But, you know, we see Froggen is constantly now pushing this top lane, and even though it bought his team a little bit of time there to get down for that inner turret, Froggen's still a nuisance here for Super Hot Crew.
Froggen's more than a nuisance. He's the only thing that can keep Alliance back. If he's able to kill moves of Mr. Riles in a team fight before they get their ultimates off, before they can deal more damage to the rest of Alliance, it can work. Now Moops is going to be the next target.
Yeah. Half of his health goes there. Moops was quick enough here. He was probably just hovering over his body slam the entire time in case Froggen happened to be hanging around there inside of the jungle. And again, he just goes straight to that top line lane. I wonder if Super Hot Crew are going to get to a point where they say, you know what, guys? We're just going to push out and go for a win if Froggen's going to be somewhere else.
The fact that Mixer's got himself a Warmog's armor on this Thresh right now is definitely going to be a testament to the fighting power that Super Hot Crew have. They don't have a traditional tank on the side of Super Hot Crew, so they've itemized around. You've got a Lock of the Iron Serai, Solari, plus a Giant's Belt for Impaler's Wukong, and that massive amount of HP for Mixer, who has been phenomenal this game. He's landed so many good hooks, and he's been in the right place at the right time for his team. Super Hot Crew now realizing that Trundle was in the bottom lane, they may want to try rush this in-hip down, but they don't have the full five-man yet.
This inhibitor is completely open, so Alliance most likely will have to give this one up or going for a bit of a risky fight. And as we can see, they just step back from that one and just going to let it go away. We've got 2 minutes now until the Baron comes up. Super Hot Crew going to just tank this bottom turret. And that's the great thing about that Warmog, that Mixer can afford to take these turrets hits at this point. That turret is going to go very low. The Culling comes out, but the turret's down. Inhibitor, I don't think, can be defended either.
This is going to be 5v4. Alliance are banking on the fact that they can defend these last two Nexus turrets. They are now going to have super minions in two lanes. However, it is evened up. Froggen is not pushing.
This is so dangerous for the Super Hot Crew. They're actually going to be stopped from recalling here. And Froggen is going on the Nexus turret. He's taken down the first Nexus turret, and he's already working on the second one. No one is able to get back. Shook is actually going to die here. Froggen's actually gone quite low in the base, and he's starting to back away. Super Hot Crew are losing men left, right, and center. Mixer taking a lot of damage. They turn around. They're going to get nipped from this one. The shutdown came in on two. Pillar, what a shot! Onto Tab. He's a dead man, and that is two men down
for Alliance. That's the name. And Tupac, who might go for a win here.
They've got the damage to do it. They've got the HP to do it. Froggen is trying to get back, and Mima is looking for him. Mima's going to try to interrupt the recall. He doesn't make it happen. Froggen has gotten back. This is going to be a 2v3. Now, Mixer has been caught by Shook, who's respawned.
Yeah, Shook coming into this one. I'm not sure how he's actually going to get away from him. The pillar. Well, he is a troll, so I suppose we'll let Wicked off from that one, stopping Shook from chasing off from that one. Funnily enough, it was a wise move because the rest of the team had all come around from that one, but my gosh, that was a scare for the Super Hot crew.
Because of the fact that there were super minions in two lanes pushing out from the Nexus, that is what forced Froggen away. He was tanking up the turret, used his intervention on those two Nexus turrets, but there were so many super minions and other minions forcing him backwards, he couldn't get the rest of the base. Now those, the fact that there's only one Nexus turret remaining means that if Froggen gets a little bit more time, he actually has the potential to shut that down, to pick up the game win. Super Hot crew have to invest in a lot of wards, and they cannot afford to ignore Froggen any longer.
Oh. I was wondering whether it was a body slam through the wall or a ward that was he was waiting for there. In the end, it was the ward.
Wicked,
but look at this.
Wicked just teleported there.
Thing is, he can tank turrets really, really well at this point. And he's got that extra damage as well from his chomp. So will he actually try and go through and take that second Nexus turret? He, of course, I was going to say has teleport, but that's a lie because he's on cooldown.
So Wicked just teleported to the lane. I think he was trying to backpack. Oh. They've got Froggen!
Oh, they've put Froggen. Oh, he's not quick enough to stop that one from happening. He couldn't get the intervention on himself. That's a minute spawn time. Froggen is by far and away the biggest damage source right now. Will Super Hot crew try and take advantage of that?
Mima found his ultimate. That was a good play, instantly throwing it down on Froggen. With Froggen not being available, who was the strongest member in Alliance, this should be a forced team fight for Super Hot crew. There are minions pushing in behind them. The minions will get to the Nexus around about the same time they want to start fighting yet. With the rest of their ultimates available, with the exception of that tomb, this is where Super Hot crew need to fight.
Pulling coming out there to get those minions away. The hook comes down onto Wicked. They're going to knock him all over the shop. He's going to die from that one. The Super Hot crew are going for this one. There's still 20 seconds until Froggen comes up. Impaler dives in towards the back. Nexus turrets are going down. The Nexus will be finished off here. And the Super Hot crew pick up the victory. It was a little bit scary for them at times. But the important thing is they got that Nexus first.
From the beginning of the game, Super Hot crew grabbed the reins. They set the tempo. And they destroyed Alliance. Impaler, once again, such a strong showing from him. We keep talking about how he gets target banned. Three junglers taken away. Swaps over to the Wukong. He's got two wins in it this weekend. And his ganks were impeccable. And that's what allowed this double AP, this damage composition to work.
And we have to say that despite the fact that Froggen did take down a Nexus turret, it was really only Froggen being able to do anything for them that game. We saw without Froggen, they had nothing in that one. And it was, by all rights, quite a one-sided game for the Super Hot crew.
It was a completely one-sided game. The double AP that Super Hot crew ran, we said how they needed to get kills. They needed to get ahead early, and they need to have the damage items to make sure it works. That's exactly what Pekka said for, you know, AP top laners for like Soez's LeBlanc. And that's what Super Hot crew did. They got the kills, and then they didn't stop. They didn't go, okay, we're ahead, let's not do anything. They forced fights, they tower dove, and they just kept rinsing and repeating and doing it over and over.
I'm scared to ask you what your biggest play from that one, because actually it might be Froggen.
You know what?
Despite the fact that they lost.
I think you could make a compilation of Mixer's hooks in this game, because he had so many good hooks. And I'm actually going to say the first tower dive, where they get Tabs and Niff, and Impaler comes in from behind with the Cyclone. As Niff is trying to get away, Mixer grabs him with a last second hook. That's definitely hashtag big play, no doubt.
Well, guys, we want to know what your favorite moments were from that game as well. So tweet to us at LOL Esports and use the hashtag LCS big plays. Great, great game coming in from that one. The Super Hot crew, well, they're looking a bit unstoppable right now.
They're looking a little hot, some might say.
Super hot, maybe some would say.
Very good performance. And I think every time we watch them, this is, I think, one of the only teams where we pose questions as Shoutcasters and say, what are they going to do to fix this? What are they going to do to fix that? This is a problem. And every week we see them, they're actually improving upon their losses. SK also in a similar boat, but to a lesser degree, because they're not racking up as frequent wins as the Super Hot crew.
Well, guys, it's time for us to take a quick break, but when we come back, Shox and Quickshot here will be talking to Mr. Riles, and then it's time for the third place Fnatic taking on the last place Millennium. Will Fnatic be able to snap their losing streak, or will Millennium get a much-needed win? We'll find out in just a few. Who are they going to go for in the end? There is Impaler going right in the middle of them. Wicked actually with the intervention, but they get time. They've killed the AD carry there at the back. This could be a whitewash fight. Double kill comes down. Froggen's going to die. He didn't have the damage to kill Mixer,